Right. Good morning. Good morning. A couple of us were dancing, or at least I was trying to. I don't want to embarrass my husband, so I won't do it too very much there. Okay. It is good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen. We have a lot to accomplish today as far as announcements and some little activities or whatever. But, and then we don't want to rush the Holy Spirit, but we'll rush announcements. Senior Adult Fellowship, coming up on Saturday, May 21st at 12 noon here in the community room. It's an all-you-can-eat pizza time. So this is exciting. And so if you have any questions, concerns, or comments, you can see Pastor Janet because she has all the answers. And she knows how to calm you down if you get a little excited about pizza. And her and Pastor Gary, they do such a great job of leading our senior adults, and we are so appreciative of all that they do. And so you want to have some good food and some hymn singing. I think Richard Bowman said he was going to sing a solo. In my world, that means solo, nobody can hear me, but I'm not sure if that's for him or not, but make sure that you do that. This will be by donation, so make sure the drinks and the pizza will be provided, but just bring some donations to cover that. If you'd like to bring a dessert, I don't think there'll be any complaints. So, chocolate, and more chocolate. All right. If you've noticed, we have, just as a reminder, we do have an offering box out in the front in case that you miss your opportunity. We want to make sure that you have plenty of opportunities to give if you do not use Givelify. And also, I think I failed to mention last week that we're started, all the children and all them will started going back upstairs at the beginning of service, but if parents could make sure you check your child in, and we're going to be updating these numbers. But I was reminded this morning when I dropped my granddaughter off. But make sure you get this, because we want to make sure that you sign your child in, and so that this is for the safety measures and security measures. And as we grow, when we do grow, it's not an if, but when we do grow and we outgrow this building, we want to put all these things into place and make sure that they're in place for safety of your children. Today, we have several graduates. Woo! We have Josiah and Emily and Araceli. And so I think somebody has something to present.
Yeah, we just want to take a second to recognize those that are graduating, because it is a huge accomplishment to graduate high school. I've been there, I've done that, and it was not always easy. So if we could have Josiah and Emily and Araceli, if you're here, just to come down front. We want to recognize you, and we want to pray over you. And as I was kind of thinking about this morning, I really felt that God was putting on my heart just a scripture to pray over you, to think over you guys. And it is in Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 6. What? Okay. Awesome. Let's give it up for these guys as they come up. We do have a gift for you, too. Okay, Araceli's coming. Awesome. Congratulations. I don't know what that was. We just want to take a moment to recognize you. I know you don't know us very well because we're the newbies here, but it's all good. We're super proud of your guys' accomplishment. Graduating high school is not an easy feat. And I just felt like God was leading me to read this verse over you guys. It's in Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 6. So be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid and do not panic before them. For the Lord your God will personally go ahead of you, and he will neither fail you nor abandon you. And I just believe that no matter where you go from here, I don't know if it's college or trade school or something else into the workforce, but I'm believing that God is going to go with you. Wherever you go, God is right by your side. And even in the times when you feel distant from God, all you have to do is take one step towards him and he's going to come running back to you. So go from here. Don't be discouraged. Trust that God is with you. So we want to pray over you, and we just want to send you off with all of our love and all of our hope that God has some amazing things for you guys, okay? So Father God, I thank you for Josiah and Araceli, God, that you are leading them, that you are directing them. God, I pray over them, and I pray that you would continue to be with them every step of the way, God, that they would be strong and that they would be courageous, God, and wherever you would lead them. Father, I pray that they would know that this body surrounds them, God. We send them out, God, in all the love and the strength that you have provided for us, God. And I pray that your spirit would be with them every moment, every day, as they go into college or wherever they're going, God. I pray that you would continually be there for them. In Jesus' name, amen. So awesome. I hope you guys enjoy the gift. There's a book and a notebook and a little goodie from us. So just congratulations, and we're so proud of you.
We are so proud of you. It's a big accomplishment, especially in our world today. Let's stand with me this morning. We're going to take up the Lord's tithe and offerings. And as you're standing, I want to read Psalm 150 to you. It says, praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and the lyre. Praise him with timbrel and dancing. Praise him with the strings and pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with the resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. We're going to take up the Lord's tithe and offerings this morning. Let's pray. God, we are so grateful that you've given us this opportunity, God, that we can come together and worship you and corporately, and that, God, we have an opportunity to give to your kingdom. That, God, you said that as we give and we are like you, it will be given back to us, God, because of our obedience of giving to your kingdom, of what you've asked, God. This is the area that you said we could test you in. That, God, we know that our needs will be met. And God, that we are under the covering of you, God, with our obedience. And Lord, I ask that you'll just bless the gift and the giver this morning. And with your name, in your name, we pray. Amen. Amen. You can bring your tithes and offerings as Pastor comes to do his.
Amen. All right. You may be seated. You what? Did I miss something? Oh. Okay, praise the Lord. This morning, not only do we have graduates graduating, we also have dedication taking place. We're going to dedicate Sophie Cummings, and go ahead, guys, and Sophie, bring up Mom and Dad and Brother James. And this is pretty exciting, because see, a lot of times when we do dedications, it's babies, but this is child dedication. This is Mom and Dad saying, you know what, we want to make sure we do this thing the right way as they are developing their family. So let me just read a scripture for you. It says Proverbs 3:1-18. It says, "My son and my daughter, never forget the things that I have taught you. If you want a long and satisfying life, closely follow my instructions. Never forget to be truthful and kind. Hold these virtues tightly. Write them deep within your heart. If you want favor with both God and man and a reputation for good judgment and common sense, then trust the Lord completely. Don't ever trust yourself. In everything that you do, put God first, and he will direct you and crown your efforts with success." So Robert and Jasminka, how long have you guys been at our church? Been about 2 years? Close to that, year and a half, and they've just jumped into to HWC with both feet, and it's exciting to watch their family grow, and she's the cutest little thing I've ever seen. So, but we want to dedicate little Sophia, the Jasminka and Robert, the child that you have is a gift from your Heavenly Father. Before the thought of this little girl ever entered into your mind, the Lord already determined that on August 18th in 2019, Sophia Graceland would be born to you, Robert and Jasminka. You would become parents yet again. Sophia's birth is therefore an occasion to celebrate and to reflect on God's goodness. Scriptures commands you as parents to teach your children about the Lord Jesus Christ. Only then will she be adequately equipped for the challenges of this life and sufficiently prepared to meet the Lord when he returns. But Sophia's spiritual welfare will not be accomplished simply by telling her about Jesus. It is the words of your mouth combined with the obvious presence of the Holy Spirit in your own life that will effectively communicate the message of God's life or love and saving power to her. The birth of Sophia needs to inspire within both of you a greater resolve to let Christ shine through you by being even more intentional in your pursuit of holiness and the supremacy of God in your house. Will you promise to lead godly lives in front of Sophia, to introduce her to the Lord as early as in her life as possible? Answer, I will. I want that a little bit louder. I will, you know. Remember, more is caught than taught. Mom and Dad, her eyes will always be watching you. As a church, we're all part of the family. As a family, we need to work together alongside Robert and Jasminka in their efforts to portray Christ to Sophia. Are we going to be merely spectators, or are we going to rise to the challenge as a church family to help this couple see these two especially raised in the love of the Lord? If that is so, answer, I will. Yeah. That's awesome. I did a little research on Sophia's name, and Sophia is from the Greek word for wisdom. Can you believe that? You're going to be a smart cookie. You know that? She probably already is. Her life has been given to you as a sacred trust. Now, how you handle this trust will affect how her life unfolds. Understand that God expects you to enlist his help to accomplish this joyful task. Day to day, her life will be developed before your eyes. Small things will be big in her young life. So treat Sophia as the gift, the special gift that she is. A well-raised child or children are a joy to their parents and a blessing to God and society. This life in your hands, handle it with care, for it deserves all the care. Take Sophia and we're going to, if you guys would stand with me, we're going to pray over Sophia and this family. Can I hold you? Can the pastor? Yes, yeah, see. And Papa, hey, Papa, pastor's got a special gift for you. Are you ready to pray? Let's pray. Dear Jesus, we thank you for this family. And Lord, we dedicate Sophia to you. Lord, we dedicate James to you. Lord, we dedicate this family to you. Lord, as they together, as agreed as a family to raise this little precious girl in your love and in your light and in your livelihood, Father, we just pray that you'll continue to anoint her. Lord, as her name even indicates wisdom, Lord, I pray that you'll give them supernatural wisdom. Lord, through this moment on, we thank you, Lord, and we give her to you. In your mighty name we pray, amen. Hey, guess what pastor's got for you? Check this out. She wanted dinosaurs. Look at this. Check that out. You want that? Yeah, okay. Here you go, Dad. There we go. There you go.
And what do you say?
Thank you. Hey, give them a hand. Thank you, guys. Worship team, come on up. I tell you what, those little eyeballs right there, she'll get whatever she wants. It's a good thing I'm not a grandpa.
Amen. The heavens declare his glory, and so will we. We should not be ashamed to worship the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. We're going to have a lot more videos like that. I think it helps us to focus in on what we're here for, to worship our Lord and Savior. Let's see.
This is a reason.
say, for the hope that you give and the joy that you bring, for the promise that heaven is waiting for me. Oh, this is the reason I say, for the cross that you bore and the debt that you pay, for the victory you won over death and the grave. Oh, this is the
yeah.
He carries me when I cannot stand. He reaches me when I reach the end.
Your name, Lord.
Jesus, your name, when the whole world shakes. Jesus, your name, I will never pray. My battle cry every night and day. I'll sing your name over everything.
Oh, yes.
I'll sing your name over everything. And oh, your name is my greatest strength.
Yes.
It fights for me and it won't relent. I cast my cares, every burden falls. For there's one name that can bear them all. Jesus, your name, when the whole world shakes. Jesus, your name.
Church, give him a hand right now. He's worthy of our praise. Hallelujah, Lord. Father, thank you so much for what you're doing here right now. Moving this place, God. As we go to the Lord in prayer this morning, just a couple things that are just extremely serious. Kelly Rogge is not doing really good. They got him on oxygen now, and he needs a miracle. If he's going to get out of that hospital, so we just need to increase our faith in here for Kelly. It's not good. And then we just got a message just this morning that Luann Johns just lost her brother last night, and lives down in Leadbetter, Texas, and it was a car accident, it looks like, or some kind of an accident, not a car. They don't have the details yet, but we need to pray for Luann and Brian as they're getting. Going through their go through now. As a family, that's what we do. We just wrap our arms around them and hold on to them and hang and cry with them and be a shoulder for them to cry on. This is a mess. God is faithful. So let's pray right now. Let's just believe God for a miracle for Kelly. Let's believe God for comfort and peace for Lou Ann and her family as they're going through this mess that they're going through. Father, you are supreme, where nothing takes you by surprise. So Lord, we acknowledge that. We acknowledge that you're in control no matter what the circumstances say. And Father, we lift up Kelly to you today, God. Lord, every one of us in here are by faith believing. Lord, you said if there were two or three, they're together agreeing as touching one thing. You're in the midst. And Father, we're believing right now for Kelly for a miracle recovery, God. Lord, he'll rise up out of that hospital bed with no ill effects, God. Lord, for Lou Ann and for Brian and their family, Lord, as they go through just this horrible tragedy that just took place, Lord, as they're trying to make sense of it, Lord, I pray that you'll just comfort them, that you'll wrap your arms around them, Father. Lord, give them peace, God, during this middle of this chaos right now. And Lord, we know that you're able to, and we thank you for that. Lord, I pray, Father, for this service this morning, that your words, God, Lord, are what is imminent to come out, Father, Lord, to touch hearts and lives. Lord, and we thank you for that. In your mighty, matchless name, we pray. Amen and amen. Our God is good. Amen. In the middle of the mess, he is still good, no matter what. Hello? All right, you guys got 90 seconds. Go find somebody you didn't come to church with. Tell them hello. Like that 90 seconds goes by fast. It does for me. Hallelujah. All right. Just a couple things. I need to correct myself. I was calling Jasminka. It's not Jasminka, right? It's Jasmina. Ah, I got it. Hey, I got a great mind. It's just the memory is just real short. And so I just want to make sure I got that corrected so you guys don't go up there and start calling her Jasminka and she's got to like fix you all because of my mistake. So, but Jasmina, so thank you so much for helping me out with that. Also, I just want to thank our church body. You know, Trey and Tammy, that we're all kind of going through this go-through, and our church family has just supported them and done so many great things for them. And I just want to thank you on behalf of our family and Trey and Tammy that it's just been a real amazing blessing to have our family. I don't understand how people can go through crazy stuff without having a church family. It really, it's beyond me how that happens. So again, thank you for your blessings on that. So, all right. We are here today to hear the word of God. So if you don't mind, I would like for you all to stand with me. We're going to do something just a little bit different this morning. Yeah, it's okay. It's not a trick thing. It's not anything like, you know, I'm going to ask for money or anything. But as you're standing, I'm going to ask you a question. And before you answer, I kind of want to explain where we're going with it. I want to ask you, how many of you are here today? How many of you are here, not just in the building, okay, but you're, and not just watching online, but you are here, present in this moment right now. If you're here, would you say, I'm here?
I'm here.
Did I hear anybody in the balcony say, I'm here? No, I'm just kidding. If you're online, I want you to just type it there in the chat that you're here. Can somebody check that out and make sure that people are responding to that? Because if they're not, then what they're doing is they're acting like they're watching us online, and they're not doing that, and I don't want that. We want everybody to be here and be present, right? So if you're here, say again, I'm here.
I'm here.
And what I want to do is take this moment and just acknowledge and thank God that we have freedom together, both physically and online, as disciples of Jesus, to feed on the bread of life and his living word. And standing in the presence of the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead to worship the Lamb of God who was slain for the forgiveness of our sins. Amen? Amen. And I want to welcome you here in this holy moment, and I'm glad that you're here this morning. And the reason that I say this is, unfortunately, some of you are not going to be here for long. Some of you maybe physically here, but in a few minutes, mentally, you're going to check out. I'm just being real, because here's exactly what's going to happen. In this moment, somebody's going to get a text message, and you're going to check me out. You're just going to end up getting into this. Heaven forbid, some of you are going to initiate a text message in the middle of my sermon. Jesus is watching you, people. Hello? Some of you won't even be able to take it for very long. You're going to have to check your Instagram because it's been like 7 minutes since you looked at it last, right? And you're going to check out. Some of you are going to be doing what I do when I go to church and I'm in your seat and it gets to be about, I don't know, 11 o'clock. My stomach starts telling me, where am I going to go eat? Hello? Anybody else want to be honest with me on that one? Yeah, okay. You might be worried about some things. Your mind might begin to drift toward the bills that you have to pay. Or maybe your mind is drifting toward that distracting person that's two rows in front of you, and you want to go up and slap them in the back of the head because they're not paying attention, because they're causing you not to pay attention, right? Because some of us in here, we know that as long as we're here this morning, we're either going to be here or we're not going to be here. We're going to check in and we're going to check out. And so this morning, what I want to do is I want to introduce this message with one of Jesus's first miracles and what he performed at a wedding feast. And if you don't know the context, it's incredibly an embarrassing moment for the host of the wedding. Just think about this. You're planning this great event. Your kid is getting married or whatever, and you run out of go-go juice. It's wine in the Bible, just so you'll know. And Jesus's own mama goes up to Jesus and says, you got to do something about this. This is embarrassing. And Jesus tells his servants, he says, go get these jars, massive jars. And the commentaries say that the jars could hold up to around 20 to 30 gallons of water. And he tells them, he says, go fill them up with water. And so the servants do exactly what Jesus said. And here's what I want you to do. He said, I want you to take that water out and serve it to the master, the guy who's putting this big party on, right? And so he says, take them to the master of the banquet. And here's where we pick it up in John chapter 2. I'll let you sit down in just a second. Let's read the word. Jesus said to the servants, fill the jars with water. So they filled them to the brim. I love that. Then he told them, now draw some out, take it to the master of the banquet. The servants, they did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. And he didn't realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water, they knew. Then they called the bridegroom aside and said, everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests get drunk. And it's what it says in the Greek after they've got too much to drink, they bring out the cheap stuff, is what they said. Now, I always thought the next line said, but you saved the best for last. But that's not what the Word of God says. The Word of God says, but you saved the best till now. And I want us to grab a hold of that this morning. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your precious word. Lord, I pray that it will just become alive to us this morning as we dive into it. Lord, that you'll touch our hearts and lives. In your mighty name we pray, amen. All right, you may be seated. Today's message is your best days are now. Your best days are now. So would you look at the person next to you and say, your best days are now? Ryan, you're going to have to, bend your neck back and talk to somebody over there. But your best days are now. And so if you're still with me this morning, your best days are now. So we're in this message series called The Way. And what we're doing is we're looking at the way that Jesus lived. Not just the truth that he taught, but the way that he lived. And one of the most striking qualities about the way that Jesus lived is that no matter who he interacted with, no matter what he was doing, he was always present in the moment. He didn't check out the minute that he got bored with the conversation, okay? He was fully present. He lived with what I call undivided attention in the moment. In fact, what I want to do is I want to show you two back-to-back stories in Scripture that illustrate Jesus' heart for the people right in front of him being fully engaged in the moment. And in fact, the first one that we find out is in Luke's gospel. Jesus is walking into Jericho. And if you can imagine, there were large crowds all around. Now, this photo that we have, this is Jericho prior. This is 1,400 years prior to the event when the walls fell down. Everybody remember the story? Joshua went through the battle of Jericho, walked around the walls, came down. So this was prior, all right? So the walls came down, then all of a sudden they built Jericho back up and the walls came back up. So they were down and then they were back up, and you've got to have this mental picture of Jesus. He's walking into this magnificent city, this walled city with all these people gathered around him, crowds fighting for his attention. As he's walking in, there's a beggar by the name of blind Bartimaeus, okay? Bartimaeus cries out, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. I don't know about you, but some of us need to start crying out to our Jesus, because some of us are blind and we don't even know it. Hello? A different sermon. So the disciples were offended when Bartimaeus hollered out to Jesus. Jesus doesn't have time for this guy. Jesus is going somewhere. Jesus is too important. He's too busy. Jesus has an agenda, right? That's what these disciples are thinking. Jesus isn't going to stop for some guy who's begging on the side of the road. And the disciples rebuked the blind beggar and said, go away. And then Jesus rebuked the disciples and he engaged with a single hurting person. Fully engaged in the moment, the Bible says Jesus stopped. Man, when Jesus stopped, that's a good indication there's going to be some devil bashing. Hello? So Jesus stops and he gives his full attention to Bartimaeus. What would you like for me to do? Is what he asked. And the man cries out, could you heal me? Could you just heal me? And I haven't been able to see my whole life. And Jesus spoke a miraculous word of faith, and the man was healed. One miracle is Jesus healed him. The second thing is to notice is that Jesus stopped for a guy that nobody else had time for. Oh, come on. He fully engaged with this person in front of him. Now, the second and next story, the consecutive story, here's one that we look up in Luke chapter 19, verse 1, and it again mentions Jericho. As Jesus enters into Jericho, and this time Luke tells us that they were actually going somewhere. He was passing through, so he was moving through, and he had somewhere to be. Jesus had to get this to this place. As Jesus entered Jericho and passing through, a man there was there by the name of Zacchaeus, okay? He was the chief tax collector, and he was wealthy. Now, If you notice, Jesus had already been interrupted one time by a poor blind beggar. Now he's being interrupted by a rich, corrupt tax collector. So what I love about Jesus is he's got time for the down and outs, and he's got time for the up and outs. Hello? He's got time for anyone. He's got a heart for everyone. It doesn't matter where you come from, how bad your baggage is, how dirty it is, how rich it is. Jesus cares for you, and I want you to get that this morning. And Jesus stops for this guy named Zacchaeus. Now, if you don't know who Zacchaeus was, let me tell you who Zacchaeus was. Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. And Zacchaeus climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted. Has anybody drank the Kool-Aid? Come on. All of us Sunday school people, come on now. That's the way it went. Well, he was a tax collector, which may not mean a whole lot to you in today's culture, because a tax collector can be a respectable, although a probably not enjoyable, paying job. But during this time, this was like the most corrupt people of all on the planet. A tax collector would be a person who would charge you what you owe the government, and then he would add to it an exorbitant amount and keep the difference for himself. And so this was one of the most despised, most hated people around, and Jesus sees this guy and he calls him by name. Jesus essentially invites himself over to lunch, and as he was going somewhere, after he'd already been interrupted once, he gives a no good sinner his full attention. Can you believe the nerve of him? He gives this no good sinner his attention, and when he was talking to Zacchaeus, Zacchaeus was this moment of deep repentance in the presence of the Son of God. And he just says something like this: I've sinned so many times, I've hurt so many people, I'm so sorry. I'll do anything I can to make it up. And then he blurts out, and you could almost feel this in him. He's kind of making this thing up as he goes, and he says, I'll give half of my possessions to the poor. He was rich. He says, I'll pay back four times to anybody that I've stolen from. And Jesus looks at this man and he says this: today, in this moment, right now, salvation has come to your house. Jesus had an undivided attention in the moment, and he stops and gives people one of the greatest gifts he could give them: his attention and his love. One of the greatest gifts that you can give anybody on this planet, church, is your attention and your love. Jesus was always fully present in the moment, and I want to be like that, but unfortunately, I'm not always like that. And I've been praying for God to help me to stay engaged in the moment of whoever's in front of me. I want to be where my feet are. Hello? I want to not just live for the happy moments or the up moments or those powerful moments, but I want to be there also even in the annoying moments. I wonder how many of you live in the middle of a lot of annoying moments right now. Anybody have any annoying moments? You start feeling the twitch, you know? Now, don't point at them if they're sitting by you, but anybody got an annoying moment sitting by them? Easy. No, don't point. You remember what it was like to come home to the kids? Everything was just a mess, getting frustrated, complaining under your breath because you didn't want your wife to know that you're complaining, right? And you got all this stuff everywhere. It's a crazy madhouse. Some of you may still experience that. Hallelujah. But now you come home to a quiet, cleaned up house and you wonder what happened. It was just like yesterday that there was so much energy in the house, and now you come home, everything's clean, everything's put in its place. But what's interesting to me is some of you you're doing the same thing that I did when our kids were little. Man, this house can't ever stay clean, you know, that kind of stuff. You're complaining today about moments you'll miss tomorrow. That's what I love about having the grandkids over. Oh my goodness, it's chaos. It's controlled chaos. No, it's not even controlled. It's just chaos, right? You're literally complaining about the very moments right now that you're going to miss one day in the future. And Jesus was fully engaged in the moment. And look, are you still here? Are you still present this morning? Because the statistical odds would show that I've already lost some of you. Harvard did a study. Now watch this. And this is what they found out. This is their exact words. 47% of the time, people's minds are not at the same place their feet are. 47% of your time, your mind is somewhere else. 47% of the time, you're in a conversation with someone and your mind isn't fully engaged with who you're talking to. Think about it for a second. 47% of the time, you're sitting in church or at dinner with your family or engaged with someone at work or talking to someone in the gym or in the middle of a life group. Almost half of your waking life, your mind is not fully engaged where the rest of your body is. Yikes. In fact, one of the biggest enemies of your attention, and I would argue that it's this thing right here. Come on. Our cell phones. In fact, it's shocking to think about this, how often that we can be distracted from the very place that you're standing. In fact, the average cell phone user, studies show, touches their phone 2,716 times, or 2,617 times a day. 2,617 times we touch these things. Can anybody say that's gross? Wash them, clean them or something? I mean, come on. Whatever's in front of you isn't as important as Bing or that potential stupid cat video that you've got to watch. Some of you will sit there and you'll be engaged in a conversation and you'll have your Instagram going at the same time. That hurts. How much, what are you telling that person? You're really not as important as this stupid cat video. Ouch, or oh my. 26,000 or 2,617 times, that is the average. Now I got great and amazing news for some of you. Some of you are way above average. Watch this, it's crazy the way this thing is. I mean, our dysfunction is just overwhelming at times. Top 10% of cell phone users touch their phones more than 5,400 times a day. Double, almost double what the average person is. I mean, we got to figure this thing out. 5,400 times a day. Are you still with me this morning? Hello. If you're not on your phone, sometimes we're playing games. Anybody ever played mind games before, just like in your head? The top two mind games that I play the win-then game, okay? The win-then game is this. One day when this happens, I'll be happy, okay? You might do that. You might know, like, when you're a kid, it's like, when I get to high school, when I graduate, then, when I get to college, then, when I get married, then, when I have kids, then, I'll go nuts. But anyway, hello. When I get a real job, then. Oh man, and diapers, never mind. So we play the win and then game. When I accomplish this, then I'll do this. And we never catch that then. It's always something in the future. Now you just happen to, many of us, we have the win then game, but we also have that we're wishing our life away game. Look, don't miss what you have now pursuing what you want later. Jesus was fully engaged in the moment. If it's not then or when, it's often the what if game. Has anyone ever played the what if game? Right? It's the what if game. It's projecting into the future. What if this happens? You might do that. What if I don't pass the test? Then what if I don't get into a good college? Then what if I don't get a good job? And then what if I don't attract a good spouse? And then what if I have dumb kids? And then what if I can't afford the braces because I don't have a good job? And then they're going to have crooked teeth, my kids. I've ruined my kids' life because I didn't pass the test. What if this happens? What if that happens? What if the government does this? What if the economy does this? What if the aliens attack and the zombies come out of the gray ground? Jesus said this, Matthew 6:34. Therefore, do not worry about what? Tomorrow. For tomorrow has enough to worry. Tomorrow worries about itself. Jesus said, don't worry about what's coming. Tomorrow will worry about itself. But what I love about Jesus is he wasn't anti-planning, okay? He said, I'm not telling you not to plan for the future, but what I'm telling you is don't worry about the future. Don't worry about it. Let me just ask you this. Are you still here this morning? Because it's really, really, really important to be present in the moment. It's really important to be present now. Why is it, do you think, that we aren't so fully present? Why are we so distracted? Sometimes it's just we're just plain distracted, but as I prayed about it, I thought about one of the reasons why we're often so not fully present. It's because we lack faith. We're all freaked out about something that happened a long time ago, and I got to figure it out or undo it, or we're all freaked out about what's going to happen in the future. And what I've discovered is all that this praying is, that the only way we can be present in the moment is to actually surrender to the past, what you can't change, and trust God for the future, which you can't control. The only way to fully be present in the moment is to let go of the past that you can't change. No matter what you do, it's gone. And you just got to trust God has it. Or you surrender your future and trust God that God is good and that he cares for you. And he's already there. And because he redeems the past and because he's good in the future, you can fully engage with the person you're standing in front of right now at that moment. It takes faith. It takes faith in God to engage in God's calling right in front of you. In fact, I love this, the way James phrased it, the half-brother of Jesus, James 4:13. He says, come now. Come now, you who say today or tomorrow, we're going to go into such and such a town and spend a year there or trade and make a profit. Those of you who used to say that, COVID happened, right? And you didn't get to go anywhere for the year. I mean, you who say you've got it all figured out, you don't even know what tomorrow brings. And he asked this pressing question, what is your life? For you're a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. You're just a mist. You breathe on glass and you see it fog up and like that, it's gone, right? That's what the Bible says your life is like, how fast your life is going. Has anybody noticed how fast life seems to be speeding up right now? I mean, good gravy. Where's Josiah? That dude was, we was in the hospital room when he was being born. Angie was in there when he was being born. And now he's graduating. It's like that. It's unbelievable. The image that really gets me often is the hourglass. And I like to think about this a little bit. This is your life, that hourglass. Okay? You're here for a little while and then the life that God has given you on this earth, it passes away in a moment. And there's three things about this that are interesting to me. One is it freaks me out that the sand is going so fast right now. Anybody ever played those games that have the timer and they got the little hourglass thing on them? You know what I do when I'm acting like I'm holding them things? I shake it. But it doesn't help. Can't get it to go faster. Tried. But I don't want that to happen in my hourglass. But the first thing to know is that no one knows how much sand is on top of your hourglass. You think you do. There's a lot of people who thought they did. There's a lot more than they really realize. But no one knows exactly how much is on top. And the second thing is no matter what you do, you can't stop the sand from flowing. Time is passing by. Every day is a gift from God, and today is a gift from God, and some of you are wishing it away. The third thing is, once the sand is at the bottom, you never get it back. Once it goes through the hourglass, Jack, it's over. You never get it back. That's why at the beginning of this message that I had you stand to celebrate that moment, because at that moment, we were together in the presence of God. The very way that we are at this moment, the most important moment in your life is now. We could say is experiencing God right now is the most important thing. God's people, and that's why David said in Psalms 118, verse 24, this is the day the Lord has made. What am I going to do? I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it. In this moment, if you're still here, and I hope you're still here with me, because I want to tell you, you can't be happy where you're not. You can't serve Jesus where you're not. You can't love people the way Jesus did where you're not. And this is the day the Lord has made. The most important moment is right in front of you. That's the most important time that we need to recognize. I used to live for the bigger moments and the special moments and the powerful moments. But the more I've been fully present, the more I recognize the most powerful moments are the smallest moments. The moments that I do get to spend with my girls. Those are the most important moments because they're gone like that. The most meaningful often aren't the mountaintop, but the conversations that I have with somebody I love. Those are the most important moments. My dad had this uncanny ability to make people that he spoke to feel like they were the most important person in the room. I never could understand this. I never could kind of get my head around it. And I used to think that my dad, he just loved to talk. I mean, he's just always talking. Like, come on, we got to go. Right? Anybody ever have a dad like that? Just talk, 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 talk. But what I see now is it was at that moment, whoever he was talking to was the most important person in the room. It blew me away when I started figuring this thing out. That's why at his funeral, they had like 700 people there because all those people he would engage with. It blew me away. He wouldn't get in a rush just and just to hurry it up, but he would engage in deep conversations. And when you finished, you walked away feeling like you were important. Now, to say our family hasn't experienced its ups and downs is an understatement, and I realize how important moments are. And that I've had a few moments with my family. And when Angie and I first got married, one of the most important moments that we had as a newly married couple, we were sitting at the dinner table. We would do that, sit at the dinner table. And I forgot what we were eating that morning or that night. And she said, would you pass the butter? And I said, sure. And I take the butter dish, and when she reaches out to get it, I just take it and just right in her hand. Just pew. I thought, ha ha, I got her, you know. Well, what does she do as a loving, special loving wife that she is? She takes her little spoon and just does the old butter thing like that. And she goes like this and just pew, right here in the forehead. By the time we got finished, we had butter on the ceiling, on the walls. Now, we were living in my dad's duplex, okay? And it had wallpaper. Oh, yeah, it was horrible. So for the next 3 days, we were pulling wallpaper off of the wall, trying to do this so that my dad didn't know that we just had a massive butter fight in his kitchen and just ruined everything. And then we ended up painting and all that kind of stuff. But those were memories. Now, you haven't lived until you work the night shift. And you're laying in bed, dead to the world. And your loving, special, sweetie wife comes walking in with a super soaker. Anybody know what those are? It can fill like 3 gallons of water in about 2.2 seconds. And luckily, I was laying on the waterbed, so we didn't ruin the mattress, but some sweet little loving wife, that's your pastor's wife, comes sneaking into the bedroom, and with no warning at all, hoses me down. Now, I could say that I deserved it, because the day before, when she was taking a shower, I took a gallon of ice water and dumped it on her. That's probably why that happened, but anyway, those are memories that you need to make. I love having memories. I love having one-on-one time with my wife. You know, we got the honor to go to Hawaii a little while ago, a couple years ago. And you know, what I loved about that trip wasn't the fact that it was Hawaii or the fact that it was beautiful or anything like that. It was that for 10 days, I had Angie to myself. I couldn't just drop everything and rush back to the States. And we were trapped on an island thousands of miles from everything. That's what was important to me. Why? Because we lived in those moments. I remember when we first got there. Have you ever been to Hawaii, like on Maui? the speed limit is 55 miles an hour everywhere. And when we got to left the airport to get to the hotel thing, I felt like we were going backwards when we were driving. But by the time that we got done with the 10 days, I didn't want to come back. I was just like slow cruising, 55 miles an hour. Why? Because God was doing a change, living in the moment. There's moments with my boys growing up, baseball games, hunting trips, working together, we're painting houses together. Last year was one of the highlights of my year because my fully grown adult son, he may or may not be sitting over here, asked Dad if he would go on vacation with him. And I was like, what? You want the old man to go on vacation with you? And we did, and we had a blast. It was just the two of us living in the moment. And then there's those little precious granddaughters, right? That we make moments with. And I tell you, time is fleeting. Things are moving so fast. You better spend time in where your feet are. You need to be in the moment at that time. Don't miss what you have now, pursuing what you want later. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Jesus lived in the moment, and he taught truth in the moment that he lived in. As he walked along, people weren't interruptions or inconveniences. They were moments and opportunities to engage and show the goodness of the love of God. The moment that you have is this moment. This is what matters. To be fair, I don't want you to feel like I'm trying to make you feel guilty this morning, because I get distracted like crazy too. Oh boy, do I ever. I can hardly be where I'm at, if that makes sense. But I'm working on it. And when you think about Jesus, if there was any time that he would have been distracted from anybody else, you can't find it. He would be consumed with whoever was in front of him. Do you remember when he was at the cross and he was hanging up there and he was the Son of God, sinless, but stripped naked, hanging on the cross, beat so bad he didn't even look like a human being, internal organs being shown everywhere, and there was another guy on a cross beside of him. And all that mattered at that moment was that individual. Because that individual confessed to Jesus, hey man, I screwed up, I've done some bad things. And what did Jesus say? Today, you're gonna be with me in paradise. Jesus had all these people. He could have called, the Bible said, 10,000s of angels to pull him off that cross. And at that moment, he stood there and he hung on that cross and he says, today, buddy, you and me. He didn't look at the crowd that hung him and start cussing them and say, you know what, you all are going to hell. It didn't matter. That one man mattered. He left the 99 to get the one. I'm glad he came after this one. I'm glad he's fully engaged with this one. So here we are today. 47% of the time we're missing out on the people that are right with us. Don't miss out on those times. I mean, with what's happening today in today's society, not to make a show of it or anything, but how many people have went into eternity these last couple of years that we just is just blowing me away. And it proved to me that I have got to be engaged right now where my feet are with whoever's in front of me. Because that's the way Jesus lived. He wasn't always trying to rush off to the next one. And it's amazing when you do that, all of a sudden, things become a lot more simple. We got a holy moment to live in. Would you stand with me this morning? Worship team, come on up. Here's the deal. None of us have the promise of tomorrow. None of us have that promise. We better spend the time that we have in the moment that where our feet are, where we love people unconditionally and live like Jesus lived. live the way that he lived. His goodness, his grace is better than we can imagine. Don't let this world rush you into doing something that you're going to regret. But spend more time with him. Spend more time with his people. Can I tell you something? You all are amazing people. I love this church. Every one of you got gifts. And you know what? Here's the saddest thing for me whenever I do a funeral for someone, especially someone that's been in the church, and I start talking to the families, and I find out all these little nuggets of gold inside their family, of their history. I didn't know that. I didn't know he was a World War II vet. I didn't know that they did this or that. And you know what? It slaps me in the face because I didn't spend time to find out about them before. So be present in the moment. You guys ready to sing a song? Go. Let's worship him this morning. Let's thank God for the moment that we have right now. He's worthy. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
I speak the name of Jesus over you.
Yes.
In your hurting, in your sorrow, I will ask my God to move. I'll speak the name, cause it's all that I can do. In desperation, I'll seek heaven and pray this for you. I'll pray for your healing.
Yes.
Circumstances will change. I pray that the fear inside of me, in Jesus' name, I pray that a breakthrough will happen today. I pray miracles over your life. In Jesus' name, Jesus' name. I speak the name of all authority, declaring blessings every promise he is faithful to.
Praise you, Lord, for this moment that we have right now. Lord, because this is the moment that you've given us. You saved your best for now. Lord, and I thank you that we can walk in your best. Lord, help us to engage one another. Lord, as a family, to give our undivided attention to each other, Lord, to be there for one another in our times of difficulty and our times of joy. Lord, thank you for building this church and helping us to walk in the way that you want us to walk in. Your example, Lord. Now, Lord, we give you praise and glory. Now, be with us, God, as we go through our separate ways today, God. And Lord, I thank you for that. In your name we pray. Amen. Don't forget, we have prayer tonight at 6 o'clock. Also, we are looking into a different platform for our social media to run our online services on. I don't know about anybody else, but Facebook, if you've listened to the service, and this worship team knocks it out of the park, and they play the music so cool that we get copyright stuff hits us, even though we paid for licenses and all that. Well, the new program that we're going to use will get us off of that. So that'll be coming here before long. I can't wait. And hopefully it'll relieve a lot of frustrations back there. So God bless you. Get out of here. I mean, before you do, go connect with somebody. Take a few minutes and connect with somebody before you leave those doors. God bless you guys.